This talk is going to consider the context of production of the full-length portrait of Elizabeth I wearing the remarkable sea monster dress. It will touch on the technical analysis of other portraits of Elizabeth I and explore the questions that remain about the production and purpose of the Hardwick portrait. What do we know about the Hardwick portrait? So I wanted to start this short talk by summarising some of what we know or think we know about the Hardwick Elizabeth I portrait. And it's worth stating at the outset that there are still many more questions than answers, and that we can most usefully do as art historians is to ask the right kind of questions to explore and unpick assumptions about workshop production. So, the date of the painting, stylistically to the 1590s, and the Countess's accounts mention a payment for the carriage of a portrait of the Queen brought to Hardwick from London in July 1599. And this picture can plausibly, but not certainly, but very plausibly be linked to that payment. It's recorded at Hardwick by Walpole in 1760. The 1601 inventory also records several pictures of the Queen, one of which was in the High Great Chamber, two in the gallery, and other pictures in the Low Great Chamber. The artist, it's previously been associated with Nicholas Hilliard on the grounds that the head bears similarity to the miniatures of the 1590s, and also with Roland Lockie, who I will be talking about more this afternoon, who'd already painted pictures for the Countess in 1592. It seems very kind of English in style and conception. It's very unlikely to have been based on a sitting from the life. And the extraordinary dress, it does remain likely that it was based on an actual design, an actual kind of physical object. Before we look at the other questions about this picture, it's perhaps worth summarising some of the things we've learnt or built on existing knowledge over the last 10 years about the practice of creating portraits of Elizabeth I. First of all, the question of survival, you know, what do we have left to work with? And so the loss of portraits from this period is extensive, and only a relatively small percentage survives. And so showing you here a few examples of the kind of damage and change to portraits of Elizabeth, and a vast number will have, of course, damaged beyond repair over the course of the centuries. So we have here a very unusual appearance now, portrait in the gallery's collection, which is overpainted, another woman. She was originally holding a snake that's now was painted over and now shows through in a very sort of odd way. A UV image of the coronation portrait of Elizabeth, just to show the amount of kind of the life that these paintings have had to get now, that you very rarely get a sort of pristine 16th century portrait. And other examples of, yes, the kind of types of image of which there would be many, but we have that have lost over time. Also the question of the production of versions of portraits and copies, this kind of continually evolving dialogue of the creation of images of the Queen. So the two last decades of Elizabeth's life saw a small industry in the production of portraits of the Queen based on a range of standardised types. So these included, for example, the famous Armada portrait, of which there are versions in a private collection at Woburn and at the Portrait Gallery. Versions of the head and shoulders with a wide ruff that you have at Cambridge that are kind of related to the Darnley portrait. And versions of the three-quarter length with a fan. And what Tarnya wanted to show here with the arrows is the way that we don't necessarily know which the prime version is, what the kind of source is. So there's a kind of circular process going on rather than a kind of necessarily something clearly linear. The original composition of these types of images may conceivably have begun with a sitting, or may, and perhaps more likely in other cases, have been based on and adapted from existing face patterns and then created into portraits, often with slightly different costume patterns. As the Queen granted few sittings, the number of surviving versions of different portrait types indicates that workshops must have been adept at creating new versions without reference to any prime or prototype. At the same time, compositions were evidently not copyrighted, that a different artist studio might create portraits of the same composition, as the recent research we've undertaken on the versions of the Armada suggests that they were all produced in sort of different studios. We also have the evidence that multiple portraits could be made at the same time using reversed face patterns, as we have here with the Phoenix and Pelican portraits, which were likely painted in the same studio by the same artist. They're on a kind of an extra large panel that's been cut in half, so the same bits of wood from the same trees in each panel. And these have a relationship to Nicholas Hilliard and the face pattern by him. What Tarnya was particularly interested in was considering the portraits of the 1590s. And like the Hardwick image, these appear to have been kind of unique commissions created for specific patrons. So we have here the Ermine portrait at Hatfield, the Dover portrait with the Cardinal and Theological Virtues, which was commissioned for Dover civic authority, and the Ditchley portrait from the Portrait Gallery, commissioned by Sir Henry Lee, probably for an event at Ditchley in Oxfordshire. And unlike the production of the other surviving portraits from the earlier years of Elizabeth's reign, as I've just shown you, the compositions of all four images, and including Hardwick, do not appear in other contemporary versions or copies. This is not to say that they weren't created, the kind of the pattern survival mean that it is possible. But if the compositions of these portraits were not recycled in other versions, why might this be? Did the patron require a kind of exclusivity of design so that their image of the Queen remained remarkable and unique? Or was there, by the 1590s, simply enough readily usable portrait compositions of Elizabeth for artists to use and utilise in order to satisfy existing demands? As the portrait of the Queen and the plethora of routine images became more familiar, commissioning a unique and personal statement of your relationship with the monarch must have had a greater symbolic value. So, what bearing does all of this have on the creation of the Hardwick picture? We cannot know if any of these eventualities may have been part of the production of this picture. For example, if another contemporary version once existed, or if the portrait was part of a multiple commission for additional patrons. It's evident that the artist considered the large scale of the picture ideally required a canvas support for ease of creation and transport. And the original artist must also have been given very clear instructions about the complex design of the dress and the positioning of the Queen on a raised platform with a cloth of honour. And such a format would allow the Queen to appear as if physically present in the house, as if in state. In addition, showing the Queen in this costume, literally wearing the sea and the land, as a mistress of the ocean, would have been highly suitable in the 1590s, in the post-Armada period. So, to touch on the questions that remain. Why did Bess decide to commission this composition in the late 1590s? When the Countess took up residence at Hardwick in October 1597, it appears she would have owned or commissioned shortly afterwards at least three other portraits of the Queen. And this work would have been an extraordinary centrepiece. But given the amount of other commissioning she undertook at this time, the painting would have formed a small part of the whole at Hardwick. And its appearance needed to be, like many of the portraits, primarily decorative. So a consideration of the possible sources for the image. What was the composition based upon? As remarkable as it is, there's a strong sense that it doesn't derive from a likeness from the life. Instead, the composition appears to be compiled from aspects of many other images of the Queen that were current in the 1590s. And this would not have been at all unusual practice for artist studios charged with the creation of a portrait of the Queen. So I have here, not that necessarily one of these is a direct source, but the types of images that could be repurposed into all different sort of scales and formats. So we have miniatures in circulation, drawings, and also prints. That the portrait has been linked more closely with this anonymous woodcut because of the very close similarity of some of the details of the face and costume. So for example, the pinks in the hair at either side of the head, the hair adornments, the crown, the necklace, the wired rail with pearls, as well as aspects of the decoration of the sleeves. However, it remains possible that the print itself derives from another source, another finished painting or miniature, and this is made more likely by the fact that the print is in the same way round as the painting. It is therefore perhaps most likely, as was suggested by Roy Strong and others, that it derives from a miniature, this ultimate likeness of the Queen. And a number of miniatures attributed to Hilliard exist from the 1590s, which employ a very similar face pattern, but different costume, jewels, and hairstyle, none of which share, however, the same composition. The consideration of the whether the dress actually existed. The late Janet Arnold's view was that the fabric was embroidered and that the irregular spacing of motifs and stitches suggested that an enthusiastic amateur might have embroidered them. And it remains possible that the petticoat was made and gifted by the Countess to the Queen. Not all of the New Year's gift rolls survived for the period, but over the course of the 1580s, the Countess routinely gave highly wrought items of clothing to Elizabeth, such as, an example, in 1589, a safeguard or outer skirt of hair-coloured satin like flames of fire of gold and garnered with buttons and loops of Venice silver. None of the surviving 1590s records show the Countess gifting clothes. At that point, like many other courtiers, she provides gold instead. But nonetheless, it was a very familiar gift exchange. So, concluding comments. In the 1590s, the extraordinary style, flat perspective, and imperfect anatomy would not have been unusual of the portrait. And the interest and ability to perfect likeness to life was not highly valued, even by many exceptionally wealthy patrons. And it's worth, I think, crucially bearing in mind that the aesthetic of this image has more in common with the decorative arts than with the idea of a mimetic painting. And it's this situation is not that unusual in the work of English artists in the 1590s, who valued both fantastical design and surface detail above overall harmony, perspective, or anatomy. Indeed, this view fits in with the idea of paintings as being interchangeable with painted cloths, tapestry, or embroidered panels. And it was perhaps this approach that guided the Countess's view of commissioning painted portraits. And I think we have a fabulous moment here when closely examining the painting, of considering it in the line of the embroideries, the tapestries, the plasterwork within the building. So finally, Tarnya wanted to express her gratitude for the staff on the Making Art in Tudor Britain project, which has taken place at the Portrait Gallery since 2007, and the funders of the project. And also to say that more information for kind of the context of the production of portraits of Elizabeth, the kind of range of them, can be found on our website. We have available a kind of database of the portraits that we've analysed during the course of the project. So thank you very much on behalf of